Good morning. I welcome you to worship at Trinity Presbyterian Church, Little Rock, Arkansas. We're so glad to have you here with us. This is a day, although it's a little past it on the calendar, where we celebrate Reformation Sunday. We celebrate our history as part of the Reformation, part of that change that came to the church, beginning with Martin Luther. We're so glad you're here. We're going to pick up some elements of our Scottish heritage, because Presbyterian Church originated in Scotland. But we're also going to remember other aspects of our tradition as well, because we really come from a diverse background. We are from Europe and Africa and Asia, all across the United States, all sorts of faith traditions. We are indeed a mixed group of individuals that somehow have come together and been woven into one tapestry by the love of Jesus Christ. So we're glad you're here to be part of that service. I want to tell you a little bit about next week. Julie and I are taking a week off, so we're not going anywhere, but I have some projects lined up at home that are non-church related. I'm going to be working pretty hard, but working at different tasks. But you're in for a treat, because Carol Clark will be here preaching on the online service next week. And if you've not heard Carol preach, make sure you tune in, because she is a masterful preacher. And we have another great preacher in the in-person service. Gordon Garlington is going to be in the parking lot worship service at 8:30. It's a great chance for those of you who want to double up and hear two great sermons that day. Come and hear Gordon and then tune in for Carol.
Good morning. I am Pastor Stan Larson. I came to Trinity Presbyterian Church in Little Rock 19 years ago as your interim pastor, as you began the search for your new pastor, which ended in the calling of Pastor Jeff. It was a wonderful time to be with you there. I brought a little bit of a Lutheran flavor to you, and during my time there, we also transitioned to the new person in the office at that time, which was Julie, and she was a blessing to me, and I'm hoping that she continues to be a blessing to you as well. At this time, my wife, the Reverend Chris Crawford, and I are in the process of transitioning. As of November the 15th, my wife, Chris, is becoming the called pastor at the Presbyterian Church of Gonzales, Texas. And at the end of this year, I will be retiring from full-time ministry, never not getting out of ministry, but continuing in other ways in ministry as we go forward. I've been asked to bring to you a call to worship. Oh God, you crafted the universe as a divine tapestry in which the well-being of the entire cosmos is forever entwined. In this election season, give us hearts and minds focused on nurturing all that you have made. Forgive us when we are unjust and or accept unjust behavior in our leaders. Remind us of your call to not withdraw from the world, but to be in the world as your very own broken and beloved children. Ignite us in a passion for the welfare of those who are most vulnerable, and empower us to lead with a love that reflects your love revealed in Jesus Christ, our Savior. O God, where hearts are fearful and constricted, grant courage and hope. Where anxiety is infectious and widening, grant peace and assurance. Where impossibilities close every door and window, grant imagination and resistance. Where distrust twists our thinking, grant healing and illumination. Where spirits are daunted and weakened, grant soaring wings and strengthened dreams. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
But again, I welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ and encourage you to call one another to worship, saying, God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. Come, let us worship God. And now we have a special piece of music by the Men's Ensemble.
From whom all blessings flow.
Let us turn to God's holy word, reading from the second letter to the church at Corinth, the fifth chapter, starting with verse 18. Listen for the word of the Lord. I'm going to actually back up. I'm going to pick up some of the earlier part that's not part of the lectionary, starting at 11. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we try to persuade ourselves. But we ourselves are well known to God, and I hope that we are also well known to your consciences. We are not commending ourselves to you again, but giving you an opportunity to boast about us so that you may be able to answer those who boast in outward appearance, not in heart. For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ urges us on because we are convinced that one has died for all. Therefore, all have died. And he died for all so that those who live may live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and was raised for them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God who reconciled us to God's self through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. So we are ambassadors for Christ, since God is making his appeal through us. We entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. As we work together with him, we urge you also not to accept the grace of God in vain. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, we pray in this moment that you quicken our hearts to your voice. For we know that in this moment of reformation, you would reform us yet again, that you would continue to be at work in our lives, reforming us, and for that to happen, we must hear you. Open our ears, quicken our hearts, allow our minds to perceive that which you say this day. In Christ's name we ask this. Amen. Hello. You see behind me the Wittenberg Castle Church doors. If we could jump in a time machine and go back, I got to do the math real quick, 503 years and 8 days, we would be standing here by these doors and we'd be witnessing one of the pivotal moments in the Reformation, really the beginning of the Reformation. We would be here with Martin Luther as he is nailing his 95 theses to the door. You probably all heard of that. Martin Luther was objecting with some of the practices of the Catholic Church, and even though he was a Catholic clergyman himself, there were things going on that he tried to change. There were many things, but in particular, one of the things that he talks about in his 95 theses is this idea of selling indulgences. I know that's a funny word. We don't use it a lot anymore. There was a man named Johann Tetzel, and he was selling indulgences, which were really kind of passes for sin. If you had done something bad and you needed to repent of it, you could go and pay a little money. They were using it to rebuild St. Peter's Basilica. You could pay a little money, and you would get forgiven that way. And that was bad enough. Luther objected because he thought it was keeping people from experiencing true repentance. They weren't doing the hard work to get back right with God, not really dealing with the issues and thinking about it. But what really infuriated him at the time was that they were selling indulgences ahead of time. For instance, if you were considering meeting your lady friend in the next town, even though you were married, and you knew the church frowned on that, you could go ahead of time and pay the indulgence and get forgiven for it before you'd even done the act. Luther had theological problems with that. Now, truth be told, the Catholic Church did too. Eventually, they did away with those practices. And most of the things that Luther put in his 95 theses that are nailed to this door are things that the Catholic Church in time did away with on their own. But in that day, when Luther did this, and this was kind of a bulletin board, it wasn't just that he was defacing church property. This would have been a common practice. He would have shown up there and put it up there for people to come by and see and read those things. But when Luther did that, the church was outraged, and eventually they cast him out. And by doing so, they created what became the Lutheran Church, and then by extension, the Presbyterian Church. So we really owe our birth to both the Catholic Church, which preserved the traditions of Jesus Christ those centuries, and then Martin Luther and the Lutheran Church, which started this whole thing we call the Protestant Reformation. Well, welcome back to the sanctuary here at Trinity Presbyterian Church. We have a surprise here from the Griffins. Ryder dropped this off at my house for a children's sermon, and we don't really have a children's sermon today, but I thought I'd share it in the grown-up sermon, if you will. One of the things that Luther objected to with Tetzel was the way that Tetzel was raising money. Not only was he selling indulgences, he was selling these little cards you could buy that were images of the saints. They were, baseball cards with pictures of the saints on them. And Luther thought that that was just not very respectful. And so I suspect he wouldn't be thrilled to know that modern capitalism has done this to him, but Luther could take a joke, and he was a man with a great sense of humor. So Luther, if you're aware of this, I hope you're laughing with us. I want y'all to see this thing the Griffins brought us. It's a treasured family heirloom. Well, Luther looks like Luther was a man who once said, without beer, there can be no theology. The way he's walking, it looks like maybe he actually practices what he preaches there. I'm not sure about that. This does remind us, though, of how important Luther continues to be to us. Not just the denomination that bears Luther's name, but also Luther's contributions to our theology is at the very heart of what it means to be Presbyterian. Luther contributed a great deal, but probably nothing was more significant than his re-emphasis of this idea that we are saved by faith alone in Jesus Christ. Luther meant, in the particular context of his time, that it wasn't necessary to have the church to offer forgiveness, that we could appeal directly to God, that we could develop our right relationship with God with confession from us straight to God without an intercessory, without an intermediate. Now, we call that the belief in faith alone, and what we do sometimes is push it the wrong way. What Luther meant was that our relationship with God was determined only by faith in Jesus Christ. But sometimes, I think, while we don't really hear it this way, we live as if this is what Luther said. If it's not essential to have the church involved in that, if it's not essential to have clergy people involved in that, that therefore means, we say erroneously, that we can have a relationship with God when we are alone. That it is faith when we are alone in Jesus Christ. And that is completely at odds with what Luther intended. Luther intended our faith to be direct to God, but be a faith that connects us to one another. While it is not a faith that's determined by the church, it is a faith that draws us in to be part of the church and part of the church community. It's at the issue of what Paul is addressing today in his letter to the church at Corinth. I want Jared to put a map on for you, and you'll see this map here. You'll see this is what we would know as Greece today, and then as well. But on one side, you'll see Turkey would be just off to your right, and on the left side would be Italy. So kind of it's got you placed right there. And if you notice, it's almost like the country is squeezed in half and comes to a tight point right there in the middle with a little landmass that connects the two parts of the country. Well, that landmass is where Corinth sits. And it is on that landmass that the city is built and determines the nature of the city. For you see, because of where it is, it got ships coming from the east and ships coming from the west that would be there in Corinth. And it was the only land bridge, so land travel would have to go from south to north, and north to south would have to pass through Corinth. What that meant is, it is a town that is uniquely situated to be connected to the world. Unlike a little town that might be way isolated, people from all over the world were constantly there. And the church at Corinth, as a result, were what we might call today early adopters. Whatever the new idea that was coming from someplace else, it showed up at Corinth first, and they would grab onto it. Sometimes I jokingly say they were the California of the world there. All the new ideas, the new fads, all even those kind of odd ideas that people have would come out of that place there. They would grab onto things. They also, though, were quick to let go of them. Paul's having a problem with the church at Corinth, and so he writes to them, and he talks to them, and he says this to them: we've got to talk about how you're treating other people. We've got to talk about how you're seeing other people. And then he goes into this long talk, and he says basically this: there was a time when Paul says, there was a time when I saw Jesus Christ from only a human point of view. I saw Christ only being human. And we all know what happened when Paul saw Christ that way. He persecuted the believers of Jesus Christ. He tried to follow the law as a good Jew, to do away with what he saw as this false prophet's teachings. But we also all know what happened to Paul and how Jesus Christ appeared to Paul and set him on the right path. Well, Paul says this: I used to see Jesus only from a human point of view, but then he came to me and he spoke to me and he changed everything and he opened my eyes. And he said, what I discovered was when you look at things from the point of view that Christ gives to us, everything becomes a new creation. Everyone becomes a new creation, including Paul, who was a sinner and an enemy of the church, became one who had spread the gospel of Jesus Christ to the known world at that time because he was a new creation. Paul says that he was reconciled by the cross. He was reconciled to be in a right relationship by the cross of Jesus Christ. For you see, Paul says it is on the cross where Christ, who is sinless and died for my sins, allowed me to be this new creation. It is Christ who interceded on Paul's behalf that changed Paul into something new, and the old, the sinful, was passed away. And all too often, Paul says, that's where we stop the story. Christ came into my life, took away my sins, and now I am part of a new creation. And we stop the story right there. But Paul says this, because we are reconciled to God, because God has sought us out and drawn us in, we are called to be agents of reconciliation. Because God has changed us, we are called to be agents of change. We are called to see those beyond us, not as with eyes of the flesh, but with eyes of the Spirit. And there's a couple of parts to that reconciliation. On the one hand, he's clearly talking about we are called to take the message of Jesus Christ to the world. We are called to share the good news of the gospel. But he also means we are called to be in relationship with those people, to be in relationship with those outsiders, to be in relationship with those people who think differently than we do, to be in relationship with the stranger. We are called to be in relationship with them so that we can show them something better. We can show them they no longer must live with their frailties and their sin and their fears, but there is a better future. There is a better promise. Years ago, I don't even remember the year, there was a movie called Educating Rita. I hope some of you saw it. It was about a woman who came from lower middle class society and desired to move forward. And she understood that the way to better her position was to become educated. And she set out on the goal of obtaining an education, but it was hard, and there were obstacles in the way. And there's this moment in the movie where this young woman is thinking about throwing it all in, throwing in the towel, and giving up, and just embracing the situation she lives in, living in the world she lives in, that her mother lives in, that all her friends and neighbors live in, and just accept it. Even though she sees more for herself, it is hard. And she's sitting there with her mom in the local pub. And everyone begins to sing a song, and they're singing along together. And she looks at her mom, and her mom is weeping. And she turns to Rita as Rita is struggling to decide whether she will push through and obtain the education. And she takes Rita's hand and she says, there has to be better songs to sing. My friends, that's what Paul is telling us. We have been reconciled to God. We have been made new. And we need to share that better song with those who struggle. We are, Paul says, ambassadors. What that means is an ambassador is someone who is from one place but serves another place. We are no longer from this world we live in. We have been sent from God to be ambassadors to this world. And Paul says, when we become ambassadors of Jesus Christ, we show Jesus Christ to the world. And we take on these three no longers. That's what Paul uses. three no longers. He says, when we are ambassadors of Jesus Christ, we no longer live for ourselves, but we live for Christ. We no longer want what it is selfishly that we need, but we want what Christ wants for us. So we no longer live for ourselves. And he says, we no longer see people from a human point of view. We no longer see their weaknesses and their frailties and their sinfulness. We no longer see the ways that they are different from us. We no longer see the things they do that anger us. But we see them with the eyes of Jesus Christ. And then here's the hardest one. Paul says, when we become ambassadors of Jesus Christ, we no longer count their sin. Do you hear that? Do you hear the significance of that? We no longer count the sin of the people around us, and Lord knows we want to. We want to keep a list of the wrongs they have done to us. We want to keep a list of the ways that we have been slighted. But Paul says, no. We are reconciled to God. We are a new creation, and this new creation no longer keeps a list. In Christ alone, we are made this new creation. Now, as I'm taping this, we do not know who is going to be the president of the United States. And I've got to tell you, if I were a betting man, I wouldn't bet. At this point, it is so close, I don't think anybody really knows. And so, I give you that caveat to say, don't hear whatever I say in response to who's the president of the United States, because I do not know yet. And that's not my intent. But I want to say this to you right now. You, as members of this church, you, as believers in Jesus Christ, have been made to be new. You have been drawn in to the body of Christ. You have been reconciled to God. And Paul says to you, because of that, you are sent out to be agents of reconciliation. What that means in this moment, for my purposes right now, is this. You've got to figure out how to be in relationship with one another. You Democrats got to get along with the Republicans. The Republicans have got to get along with the Democrats. The independents have to get along with everybody. All those political differences that we are allowing to divide us prevent us from being reconciled in Jesus Christ. Now, I'm not trying to say you have to agree. I'm not trying to say even that you can't disagree with one another. But I am saying this. When you are in relationship with a person that thinks differently than you, when you relate to them, do so through the eyes of Jesus Christ and see in them a child of God that is struggling to understand how to make this world a better place. Because whatever separates you will never be greater than the God that puts you back together. Some of you are probably wondering, if you looked at the name of the sermon, you're saying, this has nothing to do with anything he's talked about today. But here's what I've got. I want to show you this. Those of you who have been in my house and used the powder room under the stairs know that it has monkey wallpaper. I don't know why it has monkey wallpaper. It's not Curious George monkey wallpaper. It's more like nature prints. But because it has monkey wallpaper, we have this sitting on the back of the toilet. Well, one day, years ago, I hit this monkey and knocked it off the toilet, and it hit the ground and shattered into a million pieces. And Julie said, throw it away, but somehow I just couldn't bring myself to do that. She looked at it and she just saw the brokenness there, but I thought it can be restored. So I stayed up, got the super glue, and stayed up into the wee hours, put in piece after piece after piece, and I fixed this broken monkey. The reason I tell you that story is, you know why I was able to do that? Because I didn't look at all the broken pieces. I didn't look at the brokenness. What I did is I looked at it and said, this is what it can be. This is how it can look. This is what it was created to be. And I restored it. The God of all creation has looked at you and looked past your brokenness and looked past your mistakes and your sin and looked past your unwillingness to serve God and said, this is what you can be. So quit being a broken monkey and live into the reconciliation that Jesus Christ has offered you. Live in to the ambassador that Christ has called you to be. And reach out there to the people that are different than you, no matter what the differences might be. And stop seeing the brokenness in them and see the child of God. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Brothers and sisters, you who no longer live like broken monkeys, you who are now redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ, you who are reconciled to a right relationship with God by your faith in Jesus Christ, we gather together to go to God in prayer. This day, as we remember the Reformation that happened 500 years ago, we are reminded that we continue to be reformed, that we continue to be put back together by God over and over and over again. In Christ's name, we turn to God in prayer. Let us, as we begin to pray, remember those who have birthdays this week: Cody Haynes, Terry O'Brien, Melissa Clark, Rita Looney, and Houston Downs. And then Ken has asked us to remember Kelly's daughter, Summer, who has experienced some health issues. We will pray God's healing touch upon her. And Jean Dabb's mother, who is right at 100 years old, is in the nursing care facility and has COVID-19. She has some other health issues, so we lift her up and pray God's healing touch there. We lift up the Stricklands with Ruth Ann recovering from knee surgery and Steve with breathing issues continue to be there in their lives. And we lift up David Sandlin, who is, we hope, on the downside of recovering from COVID-19, almost moved past that, and as well as Nick Steele, who is recovering from COVID-19. We pray God's healing touch there. Let us turn to God in prayer. Almighty God, we lift up those we have named. We lift up those we hold in the silence of our hearts. We lift them up asking that you be at work there, asking that even beyond our understanding to ask, your presence is known. Almighty God, you have raised up servants to proclaim the gift of redemption and a life of holiness. For our spiritual forebears, Martin Luther and John Calvin and John Knox, inspired by your Spirit, we give thanks. And their ministry, through their difficulties and in spite of their weaknesses, you were their hope and their salvation. You led them and their followers to create the heritage that is our own. We praise you for the women and men, young and old, who followed them, who gave themselves unselfishly for the welfare of the church, whose commitment and vision encouraged and supported the church, their talents, enthusiasm, idealism, and dedication infused the church with energy, their outstanding gifts and witness shaped our thought and life. We praise you for these countless members of your church, whose names we now remember, those who left us this past year to join the church triumphant. We thank you for Garrett Gorder, We thank you for Ken Turner. We thank you for Jim Swink. We thank you for Marvin Donahue. We thank you for Gene Horn. We thank you for Dick Brannan. We thank you for Elizabeth Smith. We thank you for William Clark Fitz, Jr. And we thank you for Betty Moore Chase. And we give you thanks for the place of our rich tradition among the churches which comprise the body of Christ. With all your people throughout creation, give us a new vision, new love, new wisdom, and fresh understanding that we may serve you more fully. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, using the prayer he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning. Amy, Julianne, and Elizabeth are here to help us with our hymn this morning, and it is Our God, Our Help in Ages Past. And of course, we hope that you will sing along with us.
Brothers and sisters, as I do every week, I remind you that we certainly appreciate the monetary gifts you give to us, and we ask that you keep those coming in and sending them to your home churches if you're watching from somewhere else. But we ask even more that you remember that you are reconciled to God by God's redeeming love through Jesus Christ, and that God requires only this of you. All that you are, your gifts, your abilities, your relationships, your heart, your brain, to be used as ambassadors sharing the good news of the gospel. May that be your offering this week. I'm going to close our offering time with a prayer that's really a prayer for meals, but the Thanksgiving part applies to all that we have. It's an old Scottish prayer. Some hae meat and canna eat, and some nae me but want it. We hae meat and we can eat, and say the Lord be thankit. Then I'm going to send you out with a Scottish blessing. May the blessing of light be on you, light without and light within. May the blessed sunlight shine on you like a great pearl fire, so that stranger and friend may come and warm himself at it. And may light shine out of your two eyes like a candle set in the window of a house, bidding the wanderer come in out of the storm. And may the blessing of the rain be on you. And may it beat upon your spirit and wash it fair and clean, and leave there a shining pool where the blue of heaven shines, and sometimes a star. And may the blessing of the earth be on you, soft under your feet as you pass along the road, soft under you as you lie out on it, tired at the end of the day. And may it rest easy over you when at last you lie out under it. May it rest so lightly over you that your soul may be out from under it, quick up and off and on its way to God. And now may the Lord bless you and bless you kindly. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.